Turn with me to the book of John this morning, John the 15th chapter. You know, I ministered a couple of weeks on living in deception, and I feel the Lord this morning, amen. I feel that in my heart, I feel Him in my soul, I feel Him moving, amen. And I'm so thankful and so humble this morning by God that it's just unbelievable to me this morning how I feel. If I could explain to you, I feel like running, amen. But I've got to preach, amen. So I'm gonna try to preach the Word of God this morning, amen. That be all right. But we've been talking about deception, living in deception. There's so much deception in every which way that you turn this morning, every which way you look. And one of the worst things you could do, and I'll give you an example as we move into this, but something that's brought to my attention a long time ago, and I may get some of this wrong, but maybe the statistics or something, but you just bear with me, if you will, and understand the implication. Do you know how many years that people died of a common cold and they just did not have the knowledge that the answer was growing on the bread in front of them on the table, which was penicillin? They just did not have the knowledge. You know, you're looking at I believe we're moving closer and closer toward a demon-possessed world out there, and there's more and more people that's coming along that simply don't have the knowledge of so much of the Word of God, amen. And I believe that in some cases, there's been a lot of people that's been talked into this kingdom, and they don't have the knowledge of what a Christian life should produce, amen. If God's truly working in a heart, I believe it's deception, amen, to set and to believe that I'm all right and everything is okay, and there's never any evidence, there's never any fruit of that life, and there's no fruit, there's no evidence that God's working. There's so many people this morning, I believe, that are sitting in deception. And I want you to understand something as we move along, that if everything I'm saying to you this morning, if I get it wrong, it'll hurt nobody. But if I'm right about some of the things that I'm going to say this morning, a lot of our great friends are in trouble this morning. I want to ask you something. Do you know that God's working in your life? Is there an evidence that the Holy Ghost of God is manifesting in that life and pulling you in some direction, amen? Is there evidence of conviction in your life? Is there evidence of your heart being convicted, amen? Are you able to go and say and do whatever and it not bother you, amen? There's things that need to be evaluated within our own life, amen. And when you read the Word of God, you'll find out so many ways in the Word of God what He talks about, that there's so many conditions. I find that if there's so many ifs in the Word of God, amen, that's contingent on the way that something you may do that'll produce the result, but a lot of that's never preached on. It's all an easy believism, and I do believe that you can believe and be saved. I believe that, but I believe that faith without works is what? It's dead. There must be a work, amen. There must be. And I want to get into that, and I want to drive that home this morning. There must be a work in your life, amen. And I'm going to prove that in the Word of God. You see, I told you, we err not knowing the Scriptures nor the power of God. This Word of God has devoted so much Scripture, amen, to action. So much Scripture is devoted. And when you look at the word faith, you go through Hebrews 11, and every time you see the word through faith or by faith, there was an action that followed that. And I want to ask you this morning to evaluate your own life. Is there an action in your heart? Is there an action in your life? It's one thing to sit here and say that I have faith. The book of James tells me that even the demons believe and tremble. I said even the demons believe and tremble. But what we're going to define this morning in our own life is there an action that follows up with that faith? Amen. I'm telling you, we don't need an explanation of faith anymore. I've heard it explained, amen. I'm telling you, we need a demonstration of faith, somebody that'll walk in it, amen, and demonstrate that to a world out there. It's not enough to say that I believe according to the Word of God, amen. There must be a faith. Now, understand that a man's not saved, amen, by works. We understand that, and we know that by the book of Ephesians, amen. Not of works, lest any man should boast. But I can prove to you in the Word of God, and intend to do so this morning, that if there is a proper faith in a man's heart, if there's proper faith in Jesus Christ, there will be followed by a perfect work, amen. I mean, a man will be. I told you here some time back that you may not have arrived at perfection. We said, let us go on unto perfection. Pull that out of Hebrews 6. Let us go on. There's action. You see the action verb in that sentence, amen. Let us go on. You may not arrive there, dear brothers and dear sisters, but you must, amen. You must at all costs when you die and leave this world to be headed in that direction, amen. I mean, wherever the tree falls, there should it also lie. It's not time to sit down, amen. It's not time to get all you can, sit on you can, amen. It's time, amen, for action. I'm telling you, the Lord showed me some about a year or so ago. I told you about the two notches in my work belt, amen. The Lord told me it was time to take up another notch. I'm telling you that it's time for action in the house of God, amen. It's time that we live our faith, amen. It's time that we take our light out from under the bushel, amen, and let it shine, amen. It's time for me to demonstrate my faith, Corey. If I truly believe, amen, that God's able, if I truly believe that God's able to bring a revival in my life, if I truly believe that He's able to keep that which is committed to that day, amen, if I truly believe that, I'll demonstrate that by the way that I live, amen. I'll demonstrate that by living in a holy lifestyle, praise God. I will demonstrate that. You can't separate the action from faith, amen. It demands action, amen. And whenever you get to looking at the thing, amen, you'll find out in the book of Galatians that faith worketh by what? Love. You can't separate the thing. It all works together. If I love Him, I will keep His commandments, and the commandments are not grievous, amen, if I truly love Him, amen. So if I truly love Him, and there's really a proper faith that's operating in my life, there'll be a work to follow that, amen. There'll be something working there. What are you going to do on the day of judgment when you stand before God and He says, Marvin, present your works. I took my talent, Lord, and I hid it in the earth, and I done nothing. And Jesus said in that parable, thou wicked servant, take away from him and give it to the one that had the most, amen. What have you done with what God's give you? What are you doing with it, amen? Your sanctification, amen. Are you working on that? Is it working in your life? Does things that used to bother you don't bother you anymore, amen? Are you still having the same trouble with the same thing over and over and over and over and over and over again? The very evidence you must understand in the Word of God that a biblical perspective on repentance means if a man truly has repented, amen, he ain't doing what he did no more. He's repented and turned and went the other way. Do we understand what abiding in Christ truly means? In John, the 15th chapter, listen to this. Oh, there's so much scripture on what we're talking about this morning. Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. He said, every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth, or he pruneth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Are you bringing forth more fruit in your life? This Word of God teaches that you'll know them by what? Their fruits. What is the fruit of your life? You may not be allowed to be a judge, but you can be a fruit inspector. And if I'm going to look at anybody's fruit, I'd better take a look at my own garden every once in a while and just see what kind of fruit, amen, that I'm bearing in my life. Because you will know that tree, amen, according to this Word, by that fruit that's coming forth. What is the fruit that's coming out? Have you ever been pruned? We've been taught all of our life you do your pruning in the 2 months that end in Y, January and February. There will be, you listen to me, child of God, and judge what I'm about to tell you. There will be a pruning season in your life, amen. Get ready for it, write it down and believe it, amen. But whenever that pruning comes, amen, you always bear more fruit according to this Word of God. So I ask you again, are you bearing much fruit? Are you bearing any fruit? Has God ever done any pruning in your life? What is the evidence of the Holy Ghost of God working in your life? That should make me want to run to the altar. That should make me want to run to God. That should make me want to run and jump into the arms of an almighty God. It is a very deceptive thing to say that I am saved and born into a kingdom and never be dealt with ever and say that everything is all right. I'm telling you, this is a progressive walk. And all through this Word of God, you'll find that that faith will demand action. Even love demands action. For God so loved the world that He gave. The very first thing that He talked about when He said, for God so loved the world, is that He gave His only begotten Son. There must be an action in our lives. There must be an action. Is there an action in your life? Is it just merely talk? A lot of cheap preaching going on today. I feel the Holy Ghost in this. I mean, I feel the weight of the Spirit falling on this. There's a lot of cheap talk going on. Very easy to say, I love you. Very easy just to look at somebody and say you love them. Very easy just to talk about it. But it's a whole different world when you demonstrate that love, amen. It's one thing to say I love my neighbor, amen. But it's another thing, amen, whenever they come against you, amen, and all hell comes against you. It's another thing to display and to demonstrate that love and to love and to pray for those that persecute you. I'm telling you, it's a whole lot different to display the thing. It's a whole lot different to have the action of the thing. Do you have the action of the word working in your life? Every branch in me that beareth not fruit is taken, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he pruneth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. Abide in Jesus Christ. What does it mean to abide? What does the word have to say about abiding in Christ? He said, abide in me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself. There will be no fruit in that life if you are not abiding in Jesus Christ. If you're not abiding in the thing, you'll never see any fruit. So if you're not seeing any fruit, maybe the problem could be that we're not abiding. Do you understand? I want to help us. Abide in me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can you except ye abide in me. Jesus says, and you want to know what the vine is, he says you got to abide in the vine. What is the vine? Jesus said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me you can do what? Absolutely nothing without Christ. It is very imperative. We have had so many different sermons in this church, but they've all come back to one simple message. Completely and totally surrender to Him and give Him your heart. Amen. There's so many what ifs, but I can tell you this, based on the authority of God's Word, it means everything that you keep your heart right with Him. That I keep a tender heart before God, that God can deal with me, amen. It's a terrible thing to never deal with a child. It'd be a terrible thing to take those babies, and I have three of them. I'm starting to know a little bit about something what I'm talking about, amen. I have three of those children, and it'd be a terrible thing for daddy just to turn them loose and let them go and turn them over to their own selves. It's a beautiful thing for God to deal with my heart. It's a beautiful thing to abide in this thing and to have God teach me, amen, and to have the correction and the teaching of the Holy Ghost. If I'm truly abiding in this thing, there'll be an action, amen. I'll be looking, amen. I'll be exploring the Scriptures, amen. I'll be searching out the Scriptures, amen, and looking, amen, to find Jesus, amen, in every rim of this thing. If I'm truly abiding in Him, amen. It'll not be a grievous thing to go to the house of God. It'll not be a grievous thing to keep His commandments, amen, if I'm truly abiding in Him. It'll not be a grievous thing, amen, to go to my boss man and give him an honest day's wage, amen. It's not a grievous thing if I'm abiding in Jesus Christ to go home and love my wife, amen, like I'm supposed to. It's not a grievous thing, amen, whenever you're abiding in Jesus Christ and you're abiding in the vine. It's not a grievous thing to submit yourselves together, amen, and the capitulation should be put on in the fear of the Lord, amen. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of the Lord. If I'm abiding in the vine, amen, I can read and understand through Scripture how powerful the fear of God truly is. And without the knowledge of God, amen, without the promises, every provision is made in the promises. 2 Peter, amen, in the beginning of it, before the multiplication begins, he talks about all the promises, or all the provisions are in the promises, amen, and they're brought through the knowledge of God. That knowledge of God I understand through Scripture. When I'm abiding in Christ, amen, I pick up through the Scripture, amen, that it's the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. It is the fear of the Lord that's the beginning of wisdom, amen. Why would I not take God up on something like that, amen? Why would I not want a fear of God in my life, amen? Because with it, it brings the understanding of the knowledge of God, amen? For without the fear of God, there is no knowledge of God, amen? And without the knowledge of those promises, amen, it's impossible for a man to even know about them, much less abide in them or live in them. I'm telling you this morning, it's possible for you, my friend, to be living in deception, amen? It's possible, amen, for you to think everything is all right, but behave headed in destruction, amen. I'm telling you, I read a place over there where God said He sent them a strong delusion, amen, that they may believe a lie and be damned, amen. I'm telling you, there is a thing out there. You can look at that sun, it lights your path, but you keep looking into that perfect law of liberty, you stare at that sun too long, it'll blind you, amen. You cover an eye up and don't give it any light for an extended period of time, it'll never regain what it lost, amen. I'm telling you that a man can turn down a road he'll never get back from. I'm telling you that if you're not careful, amen, I read about where Lot went into Sodom over there, took his family in Sodom, but he couldn't get all of them out, amen. I'm just telling you that a man can turn and go into deception, amen, within his own self. That's exactly what he'll do, into nothing but blindness, amen. But it's a great and a powerful thing to learn, amen. This book says the fear of God is to be taught, amen, that they learn the fear of God. It's a beautiful thing to learn what the fear of God truly is, amen. For by it I can obtain knowledge through these scriptures, amen. Through it, it's the beginning of knowledge. It's the beginning of wisdom, amen. It teaches me how to humble myself and to navigate through this world, amen. I can tell you this word of God teaches me when I'm abiding in Christ and I can pick up what the Holy Ghost is saying. Everything I begin to understand that if I want to go up, I got to go down, amen. Now you take the flesh, you'll go the exact opposite way, amen. If you want God to exalt you, the word of God said to humble yourself, and in due time He would exalt you, amen. He said, but if you exalted yourself, you would be abased, amen. I'm telling you what the word of God says. You see, the fear of God's a beautiful thing, and they've ran it plumb out of the church, amen. And now you have folks sitting on the pew that are living in deception and thinking that everything is all right, but yet we're a far cry from it. I'm telling you what, I want you to look around you today. Where are the Billy Grahams? Where are the Salvation Crusade? Where are the crusades of the Salvations? Where are they at today? Where are the mighty moves of God? Where are the Wigglesworths? Where are the Mariah Woodworth Edder? It would seem that if something has took effect, amen, something has happened, all of a sudden it's come to a standstill, amen. I can tell you this, get ready, get ready, get ready in Jesus' name. I told you that everything that can be shaken will be shaken so that, amen, what can't be shaken will remain, and it's this kingdom, amen. I can tell you this morning by the almighty word of God that the strong are going to get stronger and the weak are going to get weaker, amen. You're going to come to a time, it's going to find out whether you've got true faith or not. Whenever they line you up in front of a firing squad, whenever it becomes a felony to be a Christian, amen, you'll find out whether you have the true faith. You'll find out whether you've got action, amen. You'll find out whether it's the real deal or not, amen, whenever it comes down to that. I find all through this Word of God that faith demands action. I want to drive that home to you, and I'm going to show it to you in a moment. We'll go to Hebrews 11 when we finish this. Faith will demand action. Where is the action in the church? Where is the action if I truly believe what I say that I believe? Where is the opposition, amen? They said for years that we would never shut the church down, and we were the very ones that shut it down. Do you understand, amen? I mean, where is the action, amen? Where is it that a man will rise up, amen, and die for what he believes? I know those men that flew those planes into those buildings, they were as wrong could get. But it's a scary thing whenever a man can get in a cockpit and fly itself into a building and die for what he believes, amen. And you can't even get a man to drive to the house of God on a Sunday morning and said he believed, amen. I'm telling you, it's a sad day, amen. But you take a man that's willing to die for what he believes, amen, he'll change the course of a nation. He'll change the course of everything. There's been a blanket of ignorance that's fell over the church, amen, for the most part, and the fear of God's long gone. So has the knowledge of God, amen. And the thing's just getting worse and worse and worse, amen. But I'm telling you, I believe with all of my heart that there's somebody somewhere that's going to get a hold of what we're talking about, amen. Maybe done got a hold of it, and they're getting a hold of the unadulterated version of the Word of God. And understand, we may lose a Stephen along the way, amen. But I believe God can raise up the Apostle Paul, amen, in the meantime, amen, right in the midst of it. I know it looks bad. It's going to get worse more than likely, amen. But it don't have to for me, amen. The worst thing they can do to me is kill me, and you can't scare me with heaven, amen. Where are you dwelling? telling, amen. I read over there where those plagues, I read where the end time said that it's going to come on all those that dwell on the face of the earth. Where are you dwelling? If I had the proper faith, amen, I'd have the proper action in this thing and I'd be living in another realm. Nothing would affect me here. What was it that drove those men to be lions of God? What was it that drove Isaiah to be sawn in asunder with a wooden saw, legend said? What was it that drove Peter to be crucified upside down? What was it, amen, that took Paul to the Roman chopping block over there? What was it that took millions of Christians into the fires, amen, where Nero soaked them with oil and hung them in the rose garden and played his violin? What was it? It was the action of faith. Hard to kill a man like that. Hard to smoke out a religion like that. Hard to do it under, amen. Hard to put it under. Hard to do away with it. The real faith. The one that has the action to back it up. But you take what so much of what we've had. A little pandemic hit it and it scattered the thing. It showed me something. I seen something. I realized something. Where I had my emphasis on looking at this kingdom, on the people and the things, it wasn't as strong as I thought it was. And I realized there's something that's missing. It was the action of it. Because if a man truly believes it, it is the fear of God, amen, and the fear of God, understanding through the book of James, that my faith, if you have a true and a proper faith in God, amen, it'll bridle the tongue. True faith will. Faith has no favoritism whatsoever, amen. It understands that. Faith, true faith, has no favoritism, amen. True faith in God carries with it a fear of God, amen, that understands that that doesn't please my Father, amen, and everything in me is going to go off and I have a holy hatred of sin like I do for snakes or anything else. True faith will have action. It'll turn and go the other way. True faith has action. Where is the action in our lives? Where is the action in my life? I will demonstrate my faith in my prayer. I will demonstrate my dependence upon God by my continual coming to Him. I demonstrate my faith in God that I need Him to bless whatever this mess is I may be eating out of town that I have no idea what they've done to it behind those doors. I demonstrate my faith in Him when I bow my head and say, honey, bless the food. Ask the Lord to bless this. I demonstrate my faith whenever things get almost too much to bear. I go somewhere and I say, I got to get a hold of my God. I got to get a hold of somebody that knows a whole lot more than I do. I demonstrate my faith when I go find me a bush or wherever it is you pray. I demonstrate my faith whenever I get in that vehicle and start up the road and something's not right. I demonstrate that faith in God by that prayer life. Why? Because there's an action there. Why? Because it's real. There's something to it. There's something to it. You don't believe that? This Word of God said that Noah, by faith, when God told him what was going to happen, he moved with what? He moved with fear and built an ark. He moved with fear and built an ark. Why? Because there was an action. He believed what he said. He feared God and he believed what God said was going to happen. And he moved with that fear and he produced an action. There was an action involved with his faith. He didn't just sit down and say, I believe God's going to destroy the thing because he said he was and die with them. No, he got up and put action with it. There's something about faith. God told me one time I was getting out of the shower and God spoke to me. I tell you what, I had a vision of another minister. And I just had a vision and it scared the life out of me for just a small second. I thought he was standing in my shower room. But I just all of a sudden had a vision of that pastor and he, or that preacher, and he put his finger in my face and he said this. He said not to fill their heads with knowledge, but fill their hearts with faith. I gave it a second thought and I said, God, what are you trying to tell me? He said, there is a supernatural connection. Whenever that pure faith, amen, not the dump truck load of it, but that pure small mustard seed of faith, there is a natural thing that happens whenever that pure faith touches that supernatural realm of God, amen. All of a sudden, I seen a welding arc as if two, a positive and a negative, had come together as they touched, and it caused things in this natural realm to move, this faith. It had an action. True faith will have an action. It will reach for heaven. It will reach for God with every ounce of its being. Amen. Faith don't care what it looked like, honey. Faith don't care what it smells like. It don't matter if he said we're going to the other side. We preach this. I'll bring it back to you. Jesus told him, said, get in the boat, said, we're going to the other side. The word spoke. Now, faith should have had action there to believe. The word spoke, we're going to the other side. But yet they got in their own carnal flesh, amen, with the wrong type of action. And as the thing began to fill up, they feared, amen. Whenever I should look and say, the word of God said this, I'm going to have faith and I'm going to believe it and I'm going to stand on it. I don't care if it looks like the boat's going to fall. I don't care if it looks like the boat's going to go under, amen. It don't matter what it looks like. It don't matter what it smells like. It don't matter what it tastes like. He said it's going to the other side, and my faith, I'm going to believe that in spite of all and hang on to it with every ounce of my being. That's the man that'll get things done with God. That's the one that'll reach another realm. Not the ones that are sitting down mumbling and complaining. I want you to remember something this morning, that although they saw the miracles over there in that land when God brought them out of Egypt, they saw the miracles, amen. They saw what God done, but none of them walked into the promised land. They all died. He called them in Hebrews the evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. Now you think about that just for a moment. I'm talking about action this morning. I'm talking about more than just saying, I believe, I believe, I believe. I can tell you this Bible says even the demons believe and tremble. Where is the action? This book says to count it all joy when you fall into trials and temptations. That's in the book of Peter. Count it all joy. Thank God he's going to test my faith. Amen. I got two children homeschooling. I've told you 1,000 times, if I want to know where they're at, we give them a test. Amen. I told a lady this morning on the phone, she's going through a test. I said, how are you going to know that you can make it over the mountain a couple of miles down the road if you can't make it over the molehill here? There'll be a test, amen. But true faith will rise up against that test, amen. True faith will not waver. If it's true faith producing an action that's abiding in Jesus Christ, it will not waver. It'll stand fast. It'll stand true in spite of the world, in spite of the spouse, in spite of everything. It will stand firm on the Word of God, and it'll believe it, amen, with all of its being. Doesn't matter if the world looks like it's going under. It don't matter if it looks like a plague's going to hit and wipe it all out. It don't matter if they're going to shut all the churches down or not. Faith will stand in Jesus' name. The true faith. And I believe in so many ways that faith has been tested. I believe it's being tried in so many ways. Think it not strange is this fiery trial that's come to try you, amen. Don't think that to be strange, amen. But turn and embrace that and rise up in faith and let your faith that you possess, that you profess to have, let it have a divine action, amen. Let it stand in the grace and the mercy of God. Let it stand. All hell's coming against your house. Guess what? Don't let it have it. I said, don't let it have it. Don't give in. Stand in your faith, amen. You got children this morning that you think they're going to die and go to hell? Don't let them stand in your faith and get a hold of God. Don't you give up on them is what I'm trying to tell you. Let your faith have a perfect action, amen. Let that thing work, amen. Let it work in your life. Stand. You got a husband you can't do nothing with? Rise up in faith, amen, and believe God and hold on. You got a wife you can't do nothing with, amen? Stand in faith this morning. Believe God. He's the only one that can unscramble an egg if you'll just believe Him for it. There is a supernatural connection that I'm trying to get you to see this morning in the action of faith, that whenever you step, I remember the revelation like it was yesterday. I was getting ready to come to church one morning. I climbed trees most of my life. I've told you this. Some of you hadn't heard it, but I knew a whole lot about climbing trees, and God was dealing with me. And I remember that morning, I just sat there and I just thought, and the Lord had took me out on a limb, and we go up real high in a tree and we tie in, and you've got a lifeline run to the top of that tree, and you walk out on the limbs and you rig stuff up to lower it down over the structure in the house. And I just that morning, God showed me, and I was standing at the top of the tree, and I'd mastered the belt and got up there and had the lifeline, had mastered the art of going out and cutting the limbs and walking them. And I was standing there in the spirit that morning as God was dealing with me, and I was standing at the end of the limb, and I had my lifeline run back, and God said, cut the rope. Fear came on me. The wrong kind of fear. Cut the rope. I just in the Holy Ghost. I just stood there trembling. in this vision that morning. I stood there and I trembled as I looked to see. This is my lifeline. If I cut it, I could fall and die. Workman's comp tells me that all deaths occur with anything over 30 feet, and I'm 70 feet in the air. If I cut the rope, I could die. Trust me and cut the rope. I cut the rope. He said, take a step. I said, Lord, there's no limb there. I can't take a step. He said, trust me, take a step. I said, God, I can't take a step. Do you trust me? Where's your action, Marvin? Where's your action? You say you got faith. Where's your action? Take a step. I took a step. Scared to death in a vision. It was so real to me, like it was truly happening. As I took the step, I watched the limb run out and catch my foot. He said, take another step. I took another step, and I watched the limb run. It was cold faith that I was walking in. No feeling. All the fear in the world was coming against me about falling and dying. But it was a cold faith in connection as I was abiding in my Father that morning, amen. As I was abiding in the promises, He told me He'd never leave me. He'd never forsake me. He'd go with me to the ends of the earth, amen. Even though I felt that I would die any second, amen, I still had the command, take another step, I'm with you. I can assure you, amen, that when they told him to build the ark over there, he probably for a small second might have thought that was crazy, amen. If he didn't, I know a lot of other people did, thought he had lost his mind. 120 years, he built that thing. People never saw any rain. Thought he was crazy, amen. But what happened when the rain fell? The action of that faith, when he moved by fear and took that step. You say we have faith a whole lot, but I'm telling you this morning, talk is cheap. It's cheap. It's a cheap thing for me to pick up the phone, call my wife, and say, I love you. That's cheap. It's a different thing whenever I be faithful to her. It's a different thing whenever I love her and I go home to her every night. I demonstrate that faith to her and try to provide for her. It's a different thing, amen. I can say I love them babies, but it's different whenever I stick it out. It's a different thing, amen, whenever my faith calls for action. And I look back 11 years ago when I see I stepped out on that beach down there and I took a vow with a woman. I entered into a covenant between me and her and God, amen. It's real faith, amen, that'll recognize that covenant. And it's real love, amen, that'll hold fast to it and will not step outside of it. That's real faith. That's faith in action, is living it in front of a lost and dying world out there. I'm trying to tell you this morning, it can be a cheap thing. You can have a cheap religion and sit there and have nothing, amen. But where is the action? The cold faith that we walk in. I can't imagine through some of the things they went through in the Word of God. I got to get to Hebrews 11. Verse 5, I want to read that again and follow. John 15:5. He says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, listen. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. Have we got any withered branches this morning? Maybe somehow or another you've gotten separated from the abiding in Jesus. I can tell you the best thing you could ever do, I've got good news for you. Repent. Get your heart right with God. Don't let your past dictate your future. You can get it right, amen. Get back in the grace of God and abide in it. And let faith work in your life. And then gathered them and cast them into the fire and they are burned. If ye abide in me and my words. There's that word if again. Do you know how many times things are contingent on the word if in the Word of God? So many promises are contingent on the word if throughout the Word of God. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. Did you hear that? You have a divine promise from God. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you. If you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you, if you abide in that. I submit to you this abiding in Jesus Christ is a whole lot deeper than we've ever given credit to. It's a whole lot deeper than we've ever even given thought to. abiding in Jesus and His Word abiding in me and becoming one with Jesus, amen. Walking in what? The fear of God, amen. Walking in the fear of God. I wouldn't do anything He wouldn't have me to do. Walking in a place that I could ask anything because I'm abiding in Jesus and I'm so deep and so full of Jesus that I'm never going to ask anything contrary to the will of God for my life. You talk about abiding. You talk about the power of a sanctified life, walking in the power and this newness of life, walking out this new covenant, amen. It's one thing, amen, just to hear it preached. It's one thing to read about it, but it's a whole other thing to walk it out and to live it. We've only seen a handful of men and women throughout history that truly got a hold of this thing and walked it out. Only a few. Why can't there be another one this morning? Why can't there be another one that says, you know what? I'm going to make my mind up this morning. My faith's going to have action from here on out. I'm going to have action. Go with me to Hebrews, and I just want to give you some examples as we bring it to a close. Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Hebrews, the 11th chapter says, verse 1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You say, I can't see it. Your face is working. Keep on praying. That's what he says. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Do you want a good report? You've got to have faith. Look at this. Through faith we understand. I understand through this thing called faith that I'm trying to understand this morning. I understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God so that things which are seen were made of things which do appear. You see that? Listen to this. By faith. Say by faith. By faith. Right after this word, you're going to see some what? Action. By faith, Abel offered. There's your action. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by the being dead yet, he speaketh. See the action? Look at this. Verse 5. By faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death. You see the action in that? Look at verse 7. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things seen, not seen as yet. Let me back up and read that again. I want you to get this. Verse 7. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet. Hadn't seen it. Said he moved with what?
Fear.
Moved with fear and done what?
Prepared.
Action. Prepared an ark to the saving of his house by the which he condemned the world and become heir of the righteousness which is by what?
Faith.
Verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for inheritance, done what? He obeyed. Action. He obeyed and he done what? He went out. Action. He went out not knowing whether he went. You see the limb again? Not knowing. God said to go. God said to step. God told me to step. Now God can relate to you in something you know something, but God dealt with me in something I know a whole lot about. God told me to step. I couldn't see it. It wasn't there. I knew nothing about it. There was nothing there. Just like him, whenever God told him to build the boat, there wasn't no rain. Didn't make no sense. He just done. He moved with the fear and done what God told him to, and the supernatural happened. Where's the supernatural? Do you realize this morning if I took you through the book of Acts, you go through the book of Acts, comb through it carefully, and you try to remove all those 20-something chapters, you try to remove the working of the Spirit, miracles, manifestation of the Spirit, you'd have to do away with every chapter in the Bible, in the book of Acts. You can't separate it. Yet you and I are living in a time we've seen less action than we've ever seen in the history of the church. And the church has more tools right now than it's ever had. We have Facebook, we have internet, we've got now, I've got every Bible I can think about, I can get it with my cell phone with the touch of a button. I have more tools right now, and yet it seems that we have the less action as we've ever had in all of our life. What's happened? Where is the action? By faith, and number 9, by faith, he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker was God. Faith, real faith. Through faith, verse 11, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Have you judged him faithful who has promised? Have you judged him faithful who has promised? Are you moving on what it looks like? Are you moving on fleshly impulses? Or are you standing in cold faith, biblical faith, that has action to back it up? I will demonstrate. My family ain't where it ought to be, but I will demonstrate my faith and dependence in God. I will march myself and get it out of the bed and march myself to that altar, and I will pray to God, amen, and I will believe Him to get a hold and save my loved one. I will believe that with all of my heart, amen. I will demonstrate. I will have an action, amen, of my faith, amen, and demonstrating that to the Lord, and I will hold on to it with every ounce of my being and not get shook. There's so many. Number 17, by faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. Action. God told him, by faith, he had action. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob. There's your action again. By faith, Jacob, verse 21, by faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed both his sons of Joseph and worshiped, leaning upon the top of a staff. By faith, he worshiped. By faith, I worship. You may not worship like me. I may not worship like you. But as long as the intent of the heart's right, I'm with you 100%. If you need to shout, praise God, I'm with you. If you need to sit in silence and cry, if the heart, the intention of that heart's right and you're worshiping God, I'm with you 100%. Amen. I tell you, I'll give you the right to shout if you'll give me the right to sit there on the floor and cry. How about it? If the intention of the heart's right. By faith, we'll worship God. By faith, we'll trust Him. By faith, we'll stand firm on the Word of God. This faith that demands action. Verse 23, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents. See the action? Verse 24, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer the affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. By faith he done that, church. Listen to this. You in Egypt this morning? You in bondage? You got something you can't shake? Look here, verse 27. By faith he forsook Egypt. By faith. Faith will turn. There's so many. Verse 30, by faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. By faith, the action. 31, by faith the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not when she had received the spies with peace. Verse 33, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises through faith, stopped the mouths of lion through faith, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to fight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead, raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance that they might obtain a better resurrection. Through faith, they had action. And finally, brothers and sisters, we'll end up here in the book of James. Faith without works cannot be called faith. Faith without works is dead, James 2:26. And dead faith is worse than no faith at all. Faith must work. It must produce. It must be visible. Verbal faith is not enough. Mental faith is insufficient. Faith must be there, but it must be more. It must inspire action. Throughout his epistles to Jewish believers, James integrates true faith and everyday practical experiences by stressing that true faith must manifest itself in works of faith. Faith endures trials. Trials come and go, but strong faith will face them head on and develop endurance, this true faith. Faith understands temptations. It will not allow us to consent to our lust and slide into sin. Faith obeys the word. It will not merely hear and not do. Faith produces doers. Faith harbors no prejudice. For James, faith and favoritism cannot coexist. Faith displays itself in works. Faith is more than mere words. It is more than knowledge. It is demonstrated by obedience. And it overtly responds to the promises of God. Faith controls the tongue. This small but immensely powerful part of the body must be held in check, and faith can do it. Faith acts wisely. It gives us the ability to choose wisdom that is heavenly and shun wisdom that is earthly. Faith produces separation from the world and submission to God. It provides us the ability to resist the devil and humbly draw near to God. Finally, faith waits patiently for the coming of the Lord. Through trouble and trial, it stifles complaining. This true faith, there will be an action. James 1 and 22 says, "But be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." You're living in deception if you're a hearer of the word and not a doer. You are living in deception. That was the verse that I read several months back when God gave me the messages on living in deception. "For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself and goeth his way straightway and forgetteth what manner of a man he was. But whosoever looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed." Verse number 14. "What doeth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, Depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give not those which things they are needful to the body, what doeth it profit?" 17, "Even so, if faith hath not works, is dead being alone." Verse 20, "But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead." Verse 26, "For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also." Where is our works in our own life? Do we possess true faith? Do we possess true biblical faith that brings me back to the fear of God, that I have the knowledge to live for Him, the knowledge of the Scripture to know what He's asked for me to do? When I read this Word of God, many, many times I picked this book up and was going to read it, but I found out something, it read me. And it's the faith, my response to that, the faith in action that causes me to conform to what I read, draws me, and the fear of God that seems to have left the church in so many ways. It may leave some circles, but don't let it leave you. Don't let your faith not have an action, because true faith, according to the Word of God, will demand action. It will have an action, a true faith. If you truly believe God with all your heart, you wouldn't turn it loose, would you? If you really believed it, what do you believe in God for in your life? Are you believing God for... I want you to think for just a moment. I know it's tired and we're not used to this here lately, but I want you to think in your mind just for a moment. What are you believing God for? What is something in your life that just seems impossible? Maybe it's a loved one that's lost and you just can't get to them. You just can't see any fruit of nothing. Why don't you just haul off this morning and believe God? Why don't you make your mind up, I'm going to quit mumbling about it. I'm going to quit complaining about it, and I'm going to believe God. Amen. I'm going to believe Him with all of my heart, and I'm going to pray and believe God. You see, so many times, if I could use a feeble attempt to explain this, God is not dealing with time. He's dealing with eternity. You and I are constricted by time. When you stand down here and you put a marble in the straw and it starts working its way up, it comes out before the throne of God. Me and you pray, God save so-and-so. A month later, you see no results. Well, then it's just like this. God, send me a white truck. You put that in the straw and it comes up. 2 weeks later, you don't get a white truck. Well, Lord, if I can't have a white one, I'll take a red one. And give me a red one. It goes in the straw. Well, Lord, if I can't get a red one, well, Lord, just give me a bicycle. If I can't get a truck, just give me. Well, now I'm praying for a bicycle. Well, Lord, it's been 2 or 3 months. I ain't got a bicycle. Now, Lord, give me a skateboard. And now here the Lord is in eternity, not restricted by time. And He's got the first marble coming out. Send me a truck. The next one, send me a bicycle. The next one, send me a skateboard. The next one, send me a pair of roller skates. Lord, just don't let me walk alone. Let somebody pick me up. What do you want? A double-minded man's unstable in all of his ways. Do you believe God or not? You see what I'm trying to get at? Let your faith have action. You stand in it. There's one thing that brings me back to this pulpit, church. One thing that causes me to come back and get in it. It's because I know within my heart God told me to be in it. And it's faith in what He believes. The action of that faith that I know. That's what He told me to do. Amen. And you'll find that pleasing to Him. Obedience is a powerful thing. Have you obeyed it? Amen. We're going to pray here this morning. I want to ask you something. Is there something that you want to believe God for? I want you to remember when we prayed just in a moment, Miss Barbara, I want you to remember her. Her faith getting shook this morning. She come from California. She's getting tried and tested. She's being shook this very moment. And she desperately, desperately needs her brothers and sisters to pray for her this morning. Is there something in your life that you want to pray about? Because we're all going to pray together. I don't want you to voice it. I just want to ask you, is there something big that you want to make your mind up and you want to make a declaration of your faith this morning? And you want to say, this morning, I'm going to change my attitude. This morning, I'm going to put action, not feelings. I'm going to put action to my faith, and I'm going to believe God from this day forward, and I'm going to believe Him for it, and I'm going to get into worship over it. I'm going to get into thanking Him. Amen. If that's you, I want you to slip your hand up. 2, 3, 4. There's a few. God sees your heart right where you're at. Amen. I'm going to ask you to meet me in this altar, and we're going to ask God to forgive us of where we've not believed Him, where we've mumbled. And we're going to repent where we've complained. And we're going to start afresh this morning. And whatever it is that's been bugging you, whatever it is that's got you bogged down, we're going to ask God to give you grace and mercy to get through it. And we're going to put action with our faith. Amen. Will you meet me in this altar?